friends. Old friends.
He's gonna cry.
Old faces. New friends. Young faces. That's what I see around us here today. 600 people packing the Macintosh Hall here and outside. Young and old, standing room only. This is what we can do together. Thank you for being here tonight, but in particular, I want to thank the activists that have made this happen, and the people who've been down at the office calling every member, reminding them of this meeting. Thank you. And thank you for coming not just to a general meeting, but to what party democracy, party political democracy is all about. Because we have to start tonight by remembering that we are the only party in Gibraltar that holds annual general meetings for members. The only one. Of all years that no one of my fellows would like to remember, I think. And it's important that we highlight that this year. Because although we know we're the only party that does this consistently, we have to show up the imposters that call their first meeting an annual meeting as if they held it every year. This is the only party that elects its executive like this. The only party that elects its leader every 2 years like this. This is what real party democracy is all about. This is what real party accountability is about. And when you add the fact that you've just voted on motions which have become party policy, this is what democratic party politics is all about. And you know, I think that if the GSD practiced democracy like this, they might have a different leader today. Because in a straight fight for the leadership of the GSD, they might have selected another man to lead them. But hey, I think in any other party, it would seem strange that the man who leads them today is the man who was hell-bent on destroying them a decade ago. The man who calls his previous nemesis, the greatest Gibraltarian of all time. But anyway, political schizophrenia of the worst sort. But I suppose in a party that includes people from the centre-left, the left and the right, principles are not something that really matters or gets in the way of a good speech. But those things do matter to us. Those things are what make us, the principles of democracy. That's why, true to our words, after we were elected, we have transformed our democracy. We've ushered in a new era of democracy for our nation. An era where Parliament finally meets once a month. Where the Development and Planning Commission meets in public. It sounds so normal, but it wasn't like this before the 8th of December. And today, we, all of us, together, made history when I went to Parliament to announce in the heart of our democracy that I was calling a by-election for the 4th of July. A by-election that none of us could have imagined we were going to have to fight when we were here a year ago with Charles celebrating our first year of government. We will miss him more than we can say. But a by-election nonetheless, where we all have to work to honour Charles by keeping his seat as a GSLP Liberal seat in our government. And a by-election that we deserve to win if people lift their eyes to see what has happened in the past 16 months. And it is 16 months, by the way. Even our own sometimes believe it's longer. Even the chairman thought it was a year and a half. It's only 16 months. And look at how we've already transformed our nation. The first thing we've done is that people not of this party already feel that they can trust the GSLP. They can see that we're demonstrating that everything we set out in our manifesto is not just deliverable, it's being delivered. The change you can trust is being true to its promise, because we learned the lessons of oppositions. Not because we're always right, but because we learned the lessons of what we did wrong. And that's why I want to welcome people tonight. I want to welcome the people who are here tonight, who used to be in the PDP executive and are now members and activists of this party. You are very welcome. Thank you very much. But as you can see, you don't just walk into our executive. And we don't hold a press conference when somebody joins us. Otherwise, you know, just tonight we would have spent 600 days of press conferences. And also I want to welcome the many ex-GSD voters who have identified themselves to me here tonight and in the past few days and in the past months as new supporters and members of the GSD. In which we're delivering not good, we are delivering excellent government. They are happy to accept that this party is delivering a better Gibraltar for our people. And they're now happy to identify themselves as supporters of the party that is delivering that, that represents true Gibraltarian values and qualities. And I guess that our game is the other party's loss. And that's what's making Mr. Fetum quite so angry and intemperate. Angry and intemperate, or green, or wealthy, with envy. To such an extent that he has now focused on attacking me regardless of the damage that he might do to Gibraltar in the process. But that's what anger does. It blinds you. And it's blinding him to the damage that he has done and that he is doing to Gibraltar. And even when I tell him these things in Parliament, so that he can't pretend not to know, he continues to issue these damaging statements, regardless of the effect they may have in Gibraltar. Well, I offered the GSD confidential briefings on these issues that they now are raising about our lobbying abroad, but they did not take me up on the offer. I guess that's because Danny thinks about Mr. Fetum first, second, and third, about the GSD fourth, and about Gibraltar last. In this party, I know that we have a different set of priorities. Gibraltar, first, foremost, and always. And the worst thing that the GSD have been able to say about us in the past 16 months is that our manifesto is too ambitious. Here it is. 80 pages. Very clear. They say we're going to fail. But simply by presenting the Gibraltarian public with this document, we have committed an electoral fraud. Well, we'll see. It is an ambitious manifesto. But I prefer us to be ambitious for Gibraltar than for me to be ambitious for myself, like some other parties. main difference between Mr. Fetum and me. So that when we do complete the manifesto, when we do deliver on all of our promises, when this ambitious programme has become a reality for the whole of our community, then what? Will Mr. Fetum be gracious enough to step back and not contest the next general election? Will he simply accept that the fraud was his attempt to pretend that it couldn't be done? I don't think so. So, my friends, let's use tonight to see how our political opponents say even contradictory things about the way that they try and dampen our new dawn and the one that our nation is so enjoying. Oh, by the way, Mr. Fetum sometimes wonders whether there is a new dawn or a false dawn. He should ask the civil servants who work at Number 6 Convent Place whether they think there's a new dawn or not. If things are different for them or not. Whether we ban Babuni or not. Anyway, let's look at some of this duplicity. They say that we promise too much in our manifesto and in too great a detail. And then, I mean, I can't believe that somebody could logically try and make this argument. Then, they say that we don't have a vision, that we don't know where we're going, and that we have no strategic plan for the future. Well, look, it's either one thing or the other. You can't be all things to all men, Danny. Or is it that you can't even read, mate? Because everything that we have done in the past 16 months, apart from deal with the things that were hidden and we didn't know about, and we found when we arrived at Convent Place, is set out here, step by step, word for word, including cancelling the fishing agreement that his predecessor had done. We didn't need Facebook for that. It's a clear vision. It's a clear strategic plan. It's so clear that we were able to write it all down and ask people to vote for it. But then they also say that the way that we behave breaks the rules of good government. I mean, is it that he actually wants us to constantly have to remind them of how they broke every rule of good government in the book? Do they want us to constantly have to remind people that we paid for this manifesto, but the taxpayer paid for the designs in theirs, in breach of the rules of good government? I'm happy to remind them constantly if they like. Has he forgotten that the government of which he was a member did illegal agreements that put millions of pounds into the pockets of their supporters? No, si come in libre. Millions of pounds into the pockets of their supporters? Do they want us to keep taking motions in our meetings to remind them of the 10 million pounds that they put in the hole? Look, I tell you something. Just commenting on the motion on which Joke of Des spoke, I think that the only zarzuela that we're going to see in the Theatre Royal down there where the hole in the ground is that zarzuela de Marico you might eat in one of the restaurants next door, because there isn't a theatre there anymore. Or talking about good government. Is it that Mr. Fetum wants me to have to remind him constantly that he had his car repaired at the government garage and didn't pay for the labour cost? That is bad government! GSD good government? No. GSD sounds to me like they made it up as they went along. And when things started to get wobbly, they took £150,000 of your money and mine and used it to publish a GSD newspaper that has disappeared from the face of the earth. I suppose that's what you get from a leader that says that he doesn't like Punch and Judy politics, and yet he keeps punching. That's why our government delivers excellent government, and the community can see that. People in Gibraltar today are saying, this GSLP government is the government that I associate with. This is the GSLP government that represents me. This is the way I want to see Gibraltar run. Responsibly, accountably, transparently. And what a great program we're implementing. Finally, we're spending the money not on an airport, but on refurbishing the housing estates that the GST just completely forgot about. The policy that you've all been reminded of today, Charles championed during the course of the election campaign. We're cladding blocks to stop the water ingress and to get rid of the dam at last. We're adding lifts to blocks where we're doing the works. We're adding double glazing in the windows. That's a program that I'm proud of, and it's a program that people are identifying with. But it's not a program that the GSD are happy with. They constantly criticize the cost of the refurbishment. Well, I guess at least they're being consistent in that. It's one of the few things that they are being consistent in. They didn't invest in your estates when they were in government, and they're criticizing us now for making the investment. Well, you make up your minds for yourselves, I'm sure. But we're going to continue with the scheme. And we'll also continue with a scheme that's delivered 288 flats in the past year. 288 flats handed over to people on the housing waiting list in the past year, and we haven't yet started to build the 1,000 homes that we're going to build before the next election. But I can tell you that the tenders will be awarded in the next weeks, and they will require the flats to be completed before the next election. And therefore, will even deliver on that apparently impossible promise to house everybody who was on the housing waiting list on the 9th of December 2011. And we're delivering at the same time a new power station already out to tender and a future job strategy at double the pay that people used to get on the YTS no minimum income scheme that they used to run by the GST. And those are essential. But we're also delivering a new theatre, new and bigger boats for the RGP, a new GBC, a new deal for customs officers that will be published this week, closer links to Morocco, at last, no longer ignored. Jobs for Gibraltarians first and foremost, as well as a park in the centre of our city that will become a reality by next spring, and on and on and on. And I could stay here for hours reading you all of these things that we're doing that they think are impossible to deliver. Everything we promised being delivered and on time, because we're delivering the change that Gibraltar voted for. A change that is designed to make better the lives of everyone in our community, across the social divide. Because as we said we would be, we are a government for all of Gibraltar. I told you in the run-up to the general election that the jobs for the boys would be over if we won the election, and it was. Anybody who wanted jobs for the boys had to vote GSD. They lost the election, no more jobs for the boys. Because people are not made in party political colours. All of us are created equal, and that's why we believe in equality. And I was so happy to appoint Samantha Sacramento as the first Minister for Equality in the history of Gibraltar. But when we're faced with 6 million unemployed, 6 million unemployed, just north of the frontier, we have to think first of our unemployed. It's our obligation. And that doesn't lead to us being compared to a disgraceful fascist like Jean-Marie Le Pen. Because politicians are elected by their electorates to find jobs for their people, not for the whole of Europe. Or does Mrs. Alul hyphen Hammond believe that Mr. Rajoy, Mr. Margallo, or Mr. Andaluce worry about their 6 million unemployed and our 1,000 unemployed as well? But seriously, anybody who cares to look, and on the internet now you can find this very easily, at what Mr. Jean-Marie Le Pen actually stands for, will agree with me that Mrs. Alul hyphen Hammond's comparison of Joe to that fascist is as ridiculous as it is disgraceful. Or is it that Mrs. Alul Hammond is now so besotted by Mr. Fitum's politics that she's lost sight of what Mr. Katwana, who used to be her idol before, has said in Parliament? She's forgotten that Mr. Katwana, after years of instigation by us, was the person who introduced the regime to employ only Gibraltarian cleaners on government jobs in the last year before we lost the election? Didn't she hear him say at their first public meeting outside an election in 16 years, and I must tell you, I was very disappointed by this, that Mr. Kahwana so identified with our way of handling foreign policy that he says he feels as if he were still in charge himself? Or is it that maybe Mrs. Alul hyphen Hammond thinks of Joe, me, and Peter as Jean-Marie Le Pen's? Well, look, it's up to her. She doesn't really seem to understand what she's saying, and it's really not worth saying any more than the two Joes said about this, and Pepito. But let me tell Mr. Catuana one thing. Well, two things first. Peter, I'm sorry, I don't think you're the greatest Gibraltarian of all time. Sorry. With all due respect. But I'm very sorry to say also that our foreign policy is very different to yours, mate. I don't stand, we don't stand, nobody in this room I know has ever stood for recommending an Andorra-style solution in a referendum. We don't stand for agreements to allow foreign nationals to break our laws but enforce the same laws against Gibraltarians, like the fishing agreement. And, of course, we will never allow the British sovereignty of Gibraltar to be diluted. Ever! What we do stand for, is defending Gibraltar in every international forum that will give us a hearing. That includes the Committee of 24, as well as the Fourth Committee of the United Nations. And I'll be heading there again this year. And of course, Joe will be going to the seminar in Ecuador, the UN Decolonization Seminar, which will be held next week. Godspeed. Yeah, I'm out there, one of the young Daniel. Sorry, Mr. Chairman, I'll stick to English from now on. We need to be there because we need to remind Mr. Margallo and whoever comes after him that the only people who can decide the future of Gibraltar are the people of Gibraltar. And we need to stay in government to demonstrate that. So now we, all of us in this room and in the room next door, have to work together to highlight how far we've come in these 16 months. So that the flip-flopping of the GSD is not allowed to in any way cloud what our people see we have achieved. And so that people see that when Danny says palante, he actually means un pasito palante y dos pasitos para atrás. Because that's what Gibraltar, where Gibraltar would find itself if the GSD were ever back in government. Dos pasitos para atrás. Because what we have achieved, my friends, is that we have finally brought change to Gibraltar. But we still have a lot of change to deliver for our community. So let's work together in the days leading up to the 4th of July, so that on that day, it's not going to be Independence Day. It'll be the day that we add another GSLP member to the government benches in Parliament. Gibraltar ever, and to deliver a GSLP liberal Gibraltar.